happening?
I am in the Dead Sea, in the land called Israel.
I knew but it would be an interesting answer.
But just for another week, because in the next week, I am going to be in Kansas, in the land of the United States.
No. No, I was there 53 years ago.
So I heard.
I was born in Kansas. Dorothy Gale comes from Kansas. So you're supposed to leave Kansas, not go back to Kansas.
Sorry, I have to follow my heart towards this woman I met. And we're going to have adventures together. Hopefully, we're going to get out of there at some point.
Excellent. You know, I've got a really good website for you to check out. There's a new website we just started to work on. It's the Handsome Holy Tribal Man .mystrikingly.com. Now there's not much on there, but what's on there is graphic. You know, you see some pictures and stuff, and then it has some distinctions, and we're still working on it. Maybe you could help us with some experiments or something if you get inspired.
Sounds great. I will.
Handsome Tribal Holy Man .mystrikingly.com. Thank you. Thank you for being in the Dead Sea and then going to Kansas. I think the Dead Sea is probably the only place more dead than Kansas. So. Dorothea, hello. Where are you?
Hello. I'm in Germany, in Rheinland-Pfalz, in the southern Wine Street. Very rural, very green, in the garden of my mom.
Oh, wait a minute. This is almost November, and you're outside in a t-shirt in Germany. There's something wrong with that picture.
That is something wrong with the climate change, I would say. It is,
whoa.
I would say, I don't know, maybe 20 degrees.
Whoa. Whoa.
Yeah, it's really warm.
That's probably why they cut off the gas lines from Russia. It's because you're just not going to need them this year.
We don't need it, exactly.
Oh, man. All right. Thank you. Thank you. Somebody else would like to check in a little bit, tell us what's going on. Somebody like Andrea or Catherine.
Yes, hello.
Hi.
I've been in the swamp for a few days, so this is where I am. And I'm really happy to be here because a big part of my swamp is about not feeling the lack of intimacy that I feel in my life. So I feel joy to be in that space.
You have tuned into the right channel because we're in the middle of the book where we are revealing experiments for you to do. So by the end of this session, you'll be so inspired, you'll hardly be able to stay the whole session. You're gonna jump out and start doing experiments for intimacy, I am sure. Thank you. Thank you for being there. And you know, it's so, isn't it interesting how the swamp is a meta country? You know, it doesn't matter where you are, you can always be in the swamp. Isn't that amazing? You say the swamp and everybody knows exactly where you are. You know, you go, it's the swamp. In every country you're in, you can find the swamp. God. So you don't have, anyway, I've been working on the Nano Nations website today. So I live in a nomadic Nano Nation. So it's kind of a meta conversation also because I don't actually live on a piece of land that, you know, I live in. Even if we're here in Vietnam where we are, that we're not actually in Vietnam. We're in our country inside of this place they call Vietnam. So you can walk outside and get amazing piles of green vegetables. Like, and Chloe, we went to the market today and she puts out this basket and just piles in all these totally different kinds of green vegetables. I go, what are those? She goes, they're green. I go, okay. I see we're going to be doing some experimenting when we come home. So. Thank you. Katrin, what about you?
It resonates to be in the swamp somehow. I am I perceive the pressure from life, and I'm just struggling with staying grounded and find an adult way to deal with it. I'm trying.
We have a suggestion for an experiment for all of us to try, which has to do with this, the pressure from life. Does anybody ever feel this pressure from life? So there's urgency, there's necessity, there's conditions, you know, there's stuff like that. It turns out we've been doing radical research into raw reality. That's RRRR for short, radical research in raw reality. And so what we discovered is reality arrives without any stories attached at all. Zero stories attached. So where do those stories come from? Where do they come from? And it turns out they come from us. And so every story has a purpose. And it's so weird how we would choose to have a story with a kind of purpose that creates pressure on ourselves. And so the experiment is to write down every single, you know, you can feel the pressure, follow the pressure back and write down every single source of the pressure, and it will be a story. So you write down the story that causes every single little part of the pressure. You know, it could have to do with time, it could have to do with loneliness, it could have to do with being good enough, it could have to do with, you know, connection or intimacy or money or space or the clothes in your closet. I don't know, you could have to do with your dog, it could have to do with so many different things. Or the neighbor's dog. So write down every story, the whole story, not just a couple words, write down the entire story. It has to have is in the middle, the word is in some form. Like that. You write down the whole thing and don't judge it, don't criticize it, don't anything with it. You just write it down, all of them. So you could have 20, 30 stories that you're carrying around with you that shapes the world, which is neutral. It's absolutely neutral and shapes it into something that's eating you. You're shaping the world into something that bites your ass or just undermines your presence or your credibility or your vulnerability, it undermines you or subjects you to unusual punishment. Whatever your story, and you just write them all out. And don't do anything. Just notice. It's about noticing your stories that are causing this pressure. So this is a fantastic experiment to, and the only thing you're thinking, you know, at the end is that those stories do not come from anybody else. Because, you know, people, all you guys here have different stories. I don't even know what they are. But anyway, your stories are not my stories. My stories are not your stories. We are the author of our own stories. And it doesn't matter if we copy, like some of us copy the stories of our parents or our teachers or our grandmother or something like that, TV, or we copy those stories. But by copying them, we make them our own. So this experiment is to write, to actually write down the stories that you're using to shape reality for you, for yourself. And these are not, These are not fantasy world, positive thinking stories. These have no power. These, for some reason, you can think I'm a really good person, or I have a bright future, or everybody loves me, or all these aphorism stories. These are absolutely powerless. In fact, when you put those things on your refrigerator, they reinforce the opposite. Do you ever put these little stories, stickers on your mirror, stuff like that, and you read the story and go, I'm a kind person. And you know, what goes on in your mind is like, I'm not a kind person, I'm a mean, bad, angry, horrible person, and nobody likes me. And actually, so you're reinforcing the opposite of those kind of stories. It just works that way. Good. Yes, Ava. And then Catherine.
I'm muted, Eva.
I want to tell a story. I went to the local recycling place today to get rid of some old tires and so on. And then I met on the middle of the ground, I met this woman, and she was carrying these wired things which you can put in the garden to put, you know, the protection over. And I have been looking for this, like, it's so difficult to find exactly this. And I went, she was, you know, going to this metal thing, and I was, no, stop, wait, I want those. And she was, yeah, great, take them. My husband will be really glad, and so on. And then I had another guy, and he had a bucket. And I said, can I have that bucket? And he said, yeah, no problem. It's broken, but take it. And then this sheriff guy with this jacket, you know, this person from this recycling came, this is not a bazaar, and you don't come here to take stuff. And I was, well, that woman, she just gave it to me. Yes, but not on this property. And he was like, whoa, okay. So I took the bucket and said bye-bye to that guy and left. I was finished anyway. And then I was in the garden with this, you know, child ego state of, God, I'm so pissed off. And why is the world so nasty that they're stopping the flow of, you know, she just wanted to give, and it was perfect. It was synchronicity, and what an idiot. And so I was, you know, chopping away in the garden with this rage and totally in this victim story and in this, yeah, also this hurt of having to tolerate to be told off by this patriarchal guy. Just, I don't know, do they make profit or what from the trash, from the, so. And then I thought, okay, wait a minute, I am in this story, and I'm believing this story that, yeah, I'm the victim of this guy. And then I just stopped a minute and I thought, no, actually it worked. Like, he couldn't stop the flow of the gift. It didn't work. Like, the gifts were flowing. And so I decided to believe that story and celebrate that he hadn't succeeded in stopping the flow of gifts. And yeah, that felt like a more empowering story.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, I have another a question. I listened to the thing about commitments, and the fact that I am here now is for me part of this kind of new commitments. And even though I have so much on my to-do list, I am sitting here now and take these 2 hours. And I perceive that there are many commitments in my life. They relate to the old map. I'm not doing them out of my inner will, but I do them because at one point I said yes to them. And it's very interesting for me to recognize the difference between commitments. And I recognize also a voice that is questioning why I am here. Is it a real commitment, or is it some kind of anchor like the thin thing of grass I'm holding on that gives me orientation, and at least I will have this 2 hours on Saturday. And yeah, it's like when I'm telling you this, what are you perceiving? And I'm asking this question to all.
It turns out that we're not all going to answer, because the purpose of this space is different. And if you would like that kind of support or coaching or team, there are these Telegram groups. Are you in the Telegram group? So the Telegram creation space.
Village, yeah.
Creation.
The village, again? Yeah, creation village.
Yeah, the creation village or the EHP group space, either one of those would really be perfect spaces to get feedback and have a conversation with people about that. If that is your actual question. And in terms of having doubts about why you are here, or, you know, have you made the perfect choice for this moment in your life? It would be useful probably to inspect your commitment to perfection, to making the ultimate, total perfect choice. Can anybody criticize you about the choice you've made for these 2 hours of your life? Are you trying to find, a defendable, unattackable, proof that you have made the perfect choice? Because then you cannot be criticized or attacked, you can't beat yourself up. But that all depends on a kind of a commitment to perfectionism, which is a kind of radical neurosis for your gremlin. It's a guaranteed source of gremlin food. And actually, it's a kind of self, it's a gremlin self-cannibalism. Gremlin self-cannibalism. And there's a website we have that's got great information on it about gremlin self-cannibalism. Because whenever you're arranging your world so that the net result is you're wrong, or you're bad, or you're stupid, or you're not good enough, or you're imperfect. If you're doing that, and you can beat yourself up, you can criticize and judge yourself and cripple yourself. If you're arranging to do that, you're actually doing what's called gremlin self-cannibalism. And there's a team, an experiment to work on. It's really important to do the gremlin transformation work, which that is part of. So to get on that path would be really useful, probably. So that would be one way to look at it.
Thank you
for sharing that, because it's, it's big for all of us. It's, have I made the perfect choice for this moment? I will never get these 2 hours back. And I have so many things to do. And is this the perfect choice? Well, who's going to decide? And this book, the Building Love That Lasts, is headed in the direction of the archetypal. We're in the extraordinary domain, but we're headed in the direction of the archetypal. And in the archetypal domains, and even the extraordinary domains, there are forces at work that influence our lives in ways that have a vast kind of intelligence. That if you look backwards, on your life now, you can see how the dots fit together. Because, oh yes, if I did not go bankrupt in California, if I did not go bankrupt, I would not have been able to move to Arizona and get a job as a secretary in a training company, really, because I was holding my life together until I went completely bankrupt. And then I had to give up. And that's when I finally got my job as a secretary in a training company and started on my actual life plan, to work as a trainer in a training company. But so I had to be bankrupt for that to happen. I had to go $70,000 in debt on credit cards before that would happen. And so, you can look backwards and go, I would not have changed it. I would not have, you know, I would, it would have taken me more years before I found out that I'm a medic engineer or a transformational space alchemist. You know, I'm a transformational circle alchemist. So it would have taken me years to find that out. And so you, everybody, we can look back on our lives and look backwards. You can follow the dots and get to where you are. And did you choose those things is the question. Did you make that plan is the question. And the answer is probably not. Probably it seemed coincidental or accidental. And so then if you get it that there are these archetypal forces at work in your life because you're on the path, because you're concerned about the evolution of consciousness, because you're on this path, then those forces are at work in your life and you can actually rely on those forces. And it's an interesting shift to make when your life makes no sense, when your life is groundless, when you feel powerless, when you feel overwhelmed, or you feel off, like nothing makes sense. When you feel like that, and you're radically relying on these bigger forces at work in your life, it's a wild sense of, I don't know, the aliveness of life. It's a sense of that it's worth living, even in these times where it does not make any sense, even when it's groundless. And there's forces at work taking you somewhere. And you might not figure it out for a year or two. I mean, maybe you've had that experience. I've been in a time where over a year or two, I had no rational facts, no backing, no way to back or prove that I was on some kind of useful path. And all of a sudden, afterwards, I'm in a whole new space with a whole new direction, a whole new people, and it's fabulous. And so, you know, I suppose there are no guarantees of this stuff, but I'd rather radically rely on archetypal forces and have them take me wherever they take me than letting my ego and my box kind of restrict my life to a controlled little environment where I think I'm in charge and making the decisions and I am blocking the actual forces. You know what I mean? So that's just a personal thing with me. And you may have something similar. You may be interested in giving permission to these archetypal forces of nature to work your world. And then you can, if you look backwards and go, well, those amazing things happened to me and here I am. So those forces are still here. I was not abandoned. I mean, I have this theory that if you lock yourself down into your mother's plan for you to have a partner by the time you're 30 years old or something like this. You know, you should have children and grandchildren for your mother or something like this. If you lock yourself down into that plan, you are not available for those forces to work on you. And so part of the work is to inspect your stories and find out what's behind this tension, what's behind the pressure, what's behind that. And then after you have looked at it for a while, you go, well, it loses its power. Once you make the stories conscious, they lose their power. That's the point of the exercise that we were describing. So.
This,
go ahead.
Yeah?
Yeah.
In terms of, for me, it's interesting to notice that this is a book about intimacy or relating. And at the same time, Clinton, you're talking about, you know, let the archetypal forces take you on your life journey. And I can't imagine how these two conversations cannot cohabit. Like they have to cohabit. To have a conversation about how to have a partner, extraordinary intimacy, archetypal intimacy, without having this question of what the hell are you here for? You know, what's your mission? What's your job? What's your service? Is crazy. Because how are you going to find an extraordinary, how are you going to create, you know, find a partner and create extraordinary relating if you don't know who you are. If you're not, it's not knowing who you are. If you're not doing what you are, if you're not creating what you are. So we were having this coaching yesterday with a couple, and this woman was putting these stuff on the table, and it was this, and it was this, and it was this. And then Clinton said at some point, like, I think you're bored. And you're making problems. You're making problems because you're bored, because you're not being what you are. And so then there's all this energy that's available for that is actually for creation and invention and adventure and taking risk and inviting other people and cavitating space and running game worlds. And it's all this energy available. And when it's not actually directed towards that, it needs to be used up. And of course, the primary, your primary relationship is a perfect space for this energy to be used up in problems, because there's nothing else. I've just been thinking about that for a while, that these experiments or whatever, this conversation we're having in parallel is also absolutely this conversation about what's your non-material value? What's your specialty? What kind of game world are you holding space for? Who's in your circle? You know, how many people are you holding space in your circle? Like all these conversation, because that will make you a being that is nourishing your heart and your soul. And then that's what you can offer to your partner. You get to offer that to anybody you with, but especially to your partner. So, yeah.
Can you talk more about offering it to your partner? What do you really
mean? Yeah, what I mean is then you get to be that and to share that. You get to be this radiantly ecstatic, creative, inventive person. And you get to share that with somebody else. But
how do you mean share it?
Well, what I mean is often, the relationship to relating is, I need to find my better half. You know, this is what we've told in movie. It's like, I need to find somebody who will complete me, and then after that, I will be able to be myself if I find my soulmate. And so we're looking for this person who, if I have a partner, finally, I will feel complete, or I will feel full, and then I can be in service. And that's it's a completely adolescent relationship to relationship. And the part about sharing, it's like I'm a self-entertained being. I can go anywhere, and I'm really glad to be doing what I'm doing, you know, in front of my computer, walking down the street, going shopping, and I get to talk to all these people. But in a way, it's like I'm a self-entertaining being. But to be able to be a self-entertaining being, playing around with another self-entertaining being, is so much more fun. To be able to play around, but I don't need another being to play around. It is just so much more fun. It's just extra whipped cream and cherry flavor and maraschino cherries, even if I don't eat them. So, but yeah. Does that answer your question, Clinton?
It actually brings up a bunch more questions. But it was excellent for me. Thank you. It was just this kind of, you open two or three doors, and I'm so glad that you just go through them, even though there's no script. You know, I think people could feel it, and I think that's where this space, you know, we're reading a book. The book's in black and white on paper. How's this space supposed to be alive? Well, it's alive because the book is eating us. So part of being digested by the book is that new stuff comes out. we get squeezed and dragged into other spaces. So thank you for allowing yourself to get dragged into other spaces so we could all benefit. Yes. Thank you.
I'm just going to throw stuff in then, in terms of just opening doors and putting stuff. You know, I don't know why lately I've been feeling like I'm cooking a pot. So I'm throwing ingredients in the pot. We're cooking together. And there was this conversation that also came up from this couples coaching that we did yesterday about this. I guess it's more of an archetypal conversation, but oh well, in terms of what a woman is and what a man is. And so archetypally, the woman is this everything. And so everything is connected to everything. Nothing is working perfectly. And so we have pain about, as a woman, we have pain about everything. We're angry about everything. And it's all this everythingness happening all the time. And I can imagine that for a man who is archetypally nothing, this whole everythingness is kind of crazy making. It's like, where does all this stuff come from? I mean, it's endless. I can try to fix it. I can try to talk about it. I can try to like listen, but it's this endless flow of stuff. And what came up in this coaching yesterday was being this nothingness is actually, you don't have to handle the crazy. Like, you don't have to engage in the everythingness. It's like, it's not something to handle.
You're talking to the men right now.
Yes, and I'm talking to the men. I'm talking to the men. But the men, your job is not to try to entangle the, in French we say, like those, you know, those thread put together. I don't know what you call it.
Skein.
Yeah, okay. Bless you.
Thank you for your sharing. We're glad there's a filter.
So,
I just want to repeat what you're saying.
Yeah.
So, like, what you're saying is it's not the man's job to change the everything into nothing, in the same way that it's not the woman's job to make her man into a woman, into a girlfriend. It's not a woman's job to make the man into her girlfriend by making him into everything, because he cannot be everything. He's nothing. And it's not the man's job to make the woman into nothing, because she's everything. So this is an endless, forget it. It's an evil job. You know, it's evil. It's stupid. It's inconsequential. I mean, it's just will drive you crazy. So these are big hints.
And so part of, that's exactly where I was going. And you said it in a way that I hadn't figured it out yet. But then what happens, and for me, it's been something that's been blossoming only lately, is for women to really have woman's friend, to have girlfriend, like woman's friend, that you can be everything with another everything. And you have this everythingness meeting. But, and especially for the women who are here, you know, in this conversation, sort of the edge of consciousness and discovery is probably you have some kind of witchiness or sorceressness, and so your woman friend need also to meet that part of your being. So it needs to be other witches or sorceresses or healers so that would be one of the experiment, is to start opening the doors. And that might require really emotional healing processes in terms of how women over 6,000 years have betrayed themselves and competed with each other and betrayed each other and backstabbed each other, and just ongoingly to open the doors of the possibility of having woman's friend, girlfriend. And in the process of opening the doors, to notice that this huge fear or this resentment or this rage or this grief, and to go through these processes, because without going through the emotional healing process, no way it will happen. Yeah, Clinton.
Yeah, I mean, Explain, I've been talking about this the last couple of days in various circles. And so I'm speaking with regards to that previous conversation, which is that, for example, if a woman is looking for friends, some girlfriends, some women friends, and she looks around in the world and you see these regular women, you know, ordinary women, women who have been programmed to live in the patriarchy. And you go, okay, well, I'm supposed to have some women friends, so I'm going to sacrifice myself. I'm going to downscale my perceptions, my creations, my questions, my directing my attention. I'm going to diminish that, all this, to go into this ordinariness, this gossipy sleeping world of the ordinary women, and then I will have some women friends. This is, and Chloe is not saying that. Mm-hmm. What she's saying is to stay full on, to flame on, you're in full, like the full, she said witchiness, but there's so many other words you could use for that, but be your full power on, and find two or three other witches out there in the world somehow, and they are your friends. And then when you're in the company of ordinary people, the people who have not disassociated themselves from the thought where they were hammered in school or whatever, they have not escaped any of the eight prisons or whatever. When you're with those people, you do not have to diminish yourself at all, because you can cavitate the space for yourself and you're inside the space. And just because you're in the company of another person does not mean you have to adopt or chameleon yourself into their social domain at all. Zero. You can completely. So this is an experiment for you to do is just keep holding your cavitated personal culture. And when you want to connect with another person, male or female, professional or personal, beam out this being to being connection from inside of your space into, you know, connecting with their being, and you, without diminishing the integrity of your sorcery world or, I don't know, creation world or whatever, however you want to call the world that you live in, you know, your personal culture, you know, you don't have to ever diminish that to make a connection with somebody out there who's not in your culture. You do not have to go shrink your culture down to meet their culture. You can connect without enmeshment. You can connect without agreeing. And you don't have to change them. You know, people around me all the time with all kinds of different opinions, and I just let them have their opinions. And they say, well, what do you think? And I think you've got strong opinions. And they say, well, what do you think about my opinions? I say, well, you didn't pay me enough to get my opinion about your opinions. So if you really want to pay me to get my opinions about your opinions, you're going to go in a liquid state, and I don't think you're ready for that. So, you know, let's change the conversation, because really, it's going to be an emotional healing process when somebody asks me what I think about their opinions, because I'm a wizard. You know, I'm a mimetic engineer. I'm going to take it apart down to every me, and it's not going to be comfortable. And it's one of my professions is my non-material value. And you all have your own non-material value. And so you can hold it that way. You can just go through your world creating this, whatever you're creating, be connected full on with even the lady at the grocery store. You know, so Andrea, you know, there are so many people around you, even right here on the screen. You can have, I don't know what, 16, whatever, being-to-being connections going on right now with these high-quality people, and just being drinking from it, like you're feasting on this connection with these people. You can talk to any of them anytime. Is there anybody who's willing to talk to Andrea at any time? There, you know, she calls you up, would you talk with her and be with her? Is there anybody willing to do that? Andrea, look.
I want to clarify which Andrea.
Yes, the Andrea that this applies to. So if it happens to apply to both Andreas at the same time, then this is double shooting, okay? Good, thank you. I don't think people use our teams enough. You know, like we don't use each other enough. We get these ideas like, oh, those people are busy, or they don't want to hear my problems, or blah, blah, and we make up this story, and then we stay disconnected. And in fact, a connection from one of you to any of the other of you would be a blessing. You know, it's a really a high quality connection compared to most of the other people in our worlds. Most of the other people, they're not here in this space. Well, why not? Well, there's a kind of food in this space that's, I don't know, it's like chantilly made out of light or something, I don't know, with a cherry on top or something like that. It's this, it's a kind of food that happens in this space that most people, it would fry their nervous system. I mean, they would have to try to destroy the space, because if they didn't, the space would destroy their box or their world. And so we're in this space because we're being fed by it. And the other people who are not here in this space, it's because they needed to protect themselves. There's thousands of people who know this space is happening, really thousands. And so the ones who come here are the ones who want to be fed by it. Well, those are your friends. Those are the people you want to call up, you know, once every 2 weeks or once a week or something. These people are your friends. Just talk to each other. This is, and I don't think we do that enough. I don't think we respect ourselves and each other enough, but we could really do that. So I hope that happens more and more.
Eva, you were gonna say something.
Yeah, like regarding this women friendship, I have been noticing that when I was in like women's circles, and I've been in, because I lived in community and so on, I've been in really fine women's circles, and I've always had this unease there, which I think it was just fear, because even though also in these communities there was a lot of consciousness, but still there was this unspoken thing of, so if I shine too much, I will be cut, or if I'm too dangerous here, I won't be somehow following this unspoken rule that if we women are together, then we're kind or nice to each other, because I mean, this rough thing out there called patriarchy is happening all the time. So when we get together, then finally here we get to be nice, or it's somehow this idea that being feminine is always soft and somehow this, yeah, very, so, oh, sorry. Somehow this fake niceness, and that made me not want to go to these spaces anymore. And I didn't have this distinction of, that I can cavitate next culture space even inside those spaces. And what I've noticed now is, like last Thursday, this training stopped, this Good Girl Busters training stopped or ended, and I was so incredibly nourished by being together with these other sorceresses with the purpose of initiation and getting our rage back and just, you know, busting through these fake sugar layers. It was so feeding. And so that is somehow, like, I can really recommend that. Just get a bunch of women and do these processes together. It is so fun, and it is so connecting. And that is what I want. I don't want these other, like, I don't want this fake women come together and then we're all so nice with each other. Bullshit. I don't want that.
It's what I'm, and so I'm just adding on to what Eva is saying, which is, I hope to not repeat what I said before, but I think of the Lord of the Rings movie and Gandalf. And when Gandalf is around the ordinary people, what is he really doing? And so he's always got another agenda going on. There's always a meta conversation and a meta purpose going on with Gandalf in a space. He's not socializing. And if it looks like he's socializing, he's out in different dimensions doing, well, this is you, this is us, this is our life. So whenever there's a situation going on that looks ordinary, you do not have to submit yourself to the ordinariness, and because nobody will see what else you're doing. There's a great little movie called Secret Society. It's a great little film called Secret Society. How many people have seen that? Not enough.
It's a really hidden, like, indie.
But in a room like this, it should be tofu and potatoes. That film should be around. No, really. How many people could watch that this week?
Can you write it in the chat how the name is?
Secret Society, yeah. You can find it. It's not one of those impossible to find films. It's great. And so this is you. This is your world can have. You can be in a space and everybody's kind of trying to be nice to each other and sugarcoated, like Ava said, and you're doing something else. You're there for multiple other experiment purposes going on at the same time. You're splitting your attention, you're pulling the rug out from under somebody without saying anything. You're spinning your energetic body so that anything that's a hook or a trigger just kind of goes by you. There's so many things that you can be doing at the same time. And this is what Gandalf does. And so it's a map. It's giving us a map. It's not it's not just an exciting story. It's a lot about a map of what's possible. Dor.
Yeah,
wait,
I wanted.
Wait, no, Dor, you know, I know that you didn't know, but you're here. And if you were not here, this would be me and all these women. So I'm really glad that I have another representative of nothing. I'm really glad, you know? So thanks for being here. I don't care what you say, just go ahead.
Thank you. I celebrate this with you. And I wanted to add to that I did this experiment of cavitating next to a group of my friends that are totally in modern culture. And it doesn't have to be this like resistance. I know it's not your experience, or I'm just saying that like that was my story, I guess. It doesn't have to be this hard resistance thing that like I'm against them or something. It could really be like a smooth like sail, like it's fun. I can navigate and I can like see situation coming and practice and it can be end up like an experience that connects us, because even though they're like they are more, you know, originating in modern culture, they can support me in some ways. Like they can support stuff. They're not like enemies, or they probably didn't have the chances to experience a lot of the stuff that I've gone through. So you can get a lot of supports and team from people that are, you know, not there. So it's fun to do this culture to culture or stuff like that.
Experience. Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. It's so fantastic to ask those people for possibilities. When you have authentic necessity, something happens and they become this space through which these bright principles can work. And you just ask them for something you really want information about. Phyllis, you're nodding your head, so you must have a story to tell or something. Everybody's a doorway. Everybody around you is a doorway to possibility. They're resources for what needs to happen next. That does not mean to give you their money or time or attention because, you know, they're going to rescue you. Or it's not about collecting people around who are going to send you money by Patreon or some modern culture contraption like this. This is about as a team, they're around you for a reason. You're a team. And that if something is necessary, you say, I have this question. And then you open your question, like, what are different ways that we could, what are ways that this could happen, for example, and you open up the story, and they will, if you're listening and writing down, especially if you're writing down, they will give you stuff and they won't even know where it comes from. And you just go, thank you. And then you just take off and go do the next thing. So thank you. Phyllis, go ahead.
Well, it also gives the people around you an opportunity to step into a different space. So by asking for possibilities or presenting a different question.
Have you been doing that recently? Is that you reminding you of something?
I do that when I can. I do that when I... Yeah, I do it when I think about it or when I feel like I have an in somewhere. I didn't do it yesterday, actually, now that I think about it. It was a space that I really was not enjoying and I did not do it. And so I do it sometimes and sometimes I don't. But I appreciate that question because I will do it next week when I meet with these same people if it happens again. Yeah.
Well, that's what I was trying to say before, would you can use the sensation that I don't like this situation. I'm uncomfortable with what's going on. You can use that as a reminding factor to check on what your meta purpose is. What doors could you open that would benefit other people, benefit yourself, benefit others? You know, that would be, but the trigger is, gosh, I don't like this. Something like that sensation.
I wanted to give an experiment just for a few minutes ago about this. Clinton, you were saying we're not using enough of this team to be with each other and to nourish each other. And as a practical thing, I would propose in terms of the possibility management community that we start again this weird concept of actually picking up the phone and calling people. Instead of planning a Zoom call in 3 weeks, where it's like the thing you wanted to share is not relevant at all because you've died 72 times between the time you made the appointment and the time you're meeting the person. And so, you know, there's this great thing on Telegram that tells you that somebody's online. And so as a practical experiment for next week could be 3 times a day, you know, a couple of times a day, when you see this green light, for these people who are here, you know, people that you love, you just call them up and say, I saw you were online and I was online. And so now we're, you know, in line.
We're standing in line together.
Turning around the
post office. We're standing in line at the post office together. Can we talk?
Yeah. And I've been doing that lately and it's just fantastic and things, yeah, so much synchronicity and feeding and radiance just happen. So I'm proposing that as an experiment.
Sonia Gonzalez, could you say, it looks like you're thinking a bunch of stuff. Could you just say something?
Yes, I am thinking in a lot of things. And right now what you brought up, and Chloe, I am still in the swamp, and now with the laughter and the joy, I feel like, okay, I'm starting to get my head out of it. And I was just contacting people before this study group session and say, are you available for a listening space? And I was just thinking right now how weird it is to put things into a frame, like, when can I call you? When is it okay to reach out? And it's like, I'm putting myself into a lot of prisons and I'm not reaching people. And today I asked someone and I was like, I'm not going to wait. I'm going to ask a bunch of people and see who is available. But now I really want to go into this space of, I'm just going to pick up the phone and call. And if they pick up, it's okay. If they don't pick up, I'll call someone else. So thank you. I'm just like, thank you.
So if you had made the call, or if you made the call now, what is it that you need to say?
I want to connect. I want to have deep, nourishing conversations with someone. Are you available for this? I want to share what's going on in my life, and I want to know about you. What's going on in your life? This is what I want.
Please tell us one little thing that's going on in your life.
I am creating experiments for the first time and having fun about it. So I just bought 4 big pieces of white paper, and I put them on the wall of my bedroom. And I wrote physical body, emotional body, energetic body, and intellectual body. And for the next 4 weeks, I'm going to experiment on this and see what foods do my bodies need? What foods do they want? This is what's going on for now, like small part. Thank you for asking.
Sonia, I did and I'm still doing the same experiment. So contact me about your researches.
Yes, I want to. Thank you. I'm happy.
Me too, please. I'm into that right now also.
Yay. Hey, Isabel, I just posted your article to the Jewels of Possibility website. It's just a collection of articles, the one about the school teacher to experimenter. And I need a photograph of you, really just a straight, non-smiley face, not selfie photo. Could you just send me one? That'd be great.
And yes.
Thank you. And if other people, if you guys have other articles that you're really turned on by that you don't see on the Jewel of Possibility website, just tell us and we'll put them up to share them with everybody. If you have favorite articles from somebody in the possibility management world, that'd be great. Thank you. And I just need to hear Callisto. Will you talk to us for a second? Can you do it on Chloe, or is she going
to? I can ask to unmute. I don't know if I can really unmute.
There, thank you.
Okay.
I'm using a different device. Yes, good morning. Hello.
Hi.
I was just going to share my, when you were asking, I said, tonight I'm going to be a witch. Tonight I am a witch, and with all full black costume, and I'm looking so forward to it, to let my that come out. I'm gonna looking, yeah.
That big feeling there, mm-hmm. Big feeling that you kind of were holding it in, you know, it's safe enough to let it really come and be seen here.
Yes.
You know, but it's like, it sounds like somehow you've been holding that part really back or something, or hiding it or something.
Yes.
Okay, well, thank I'm glad. You. Yeah, I hope that when you take the black thing off, that you don't take the being part of it off. You know, after, are you going to a party or a dinner or something like that?
Yes, both. And yes, a dance.
Yeah. Yeah. So when you take that thing off, don't take that part of yourself off. You know, let it wake that part up, and then take the robe off, but you keep the part of your being alive, and find how other ways you can feed it are the ways to feed it.
Right. Yes.
Thank you.
And if you see, I have a new joy in my life. She's 16 weeks.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. It always surprises people have these things in their lives, you know. God, preachers. Okay. All right. Now I'm freaked out. All right. Anybody else would like to say something right now? Anybody else try? Did you try any of the first three experiments that we knocked open last week? Anybody try any of those?
Yes. I did the shift and was for 4 days. I shifted to and told everyone I am an experimenter. And also in Telegram, I put my name. I did not Isabel Estelle for a time, then I changed it because some people were confused about it. And I did experimenter Isabel Estelle. And after four days, I was excited about it. And I felt, okay, my gremlin is so turned on by doing experiments. And yeah, and I experiment a lot with my bodies, with my gremlin and my child and like what they need. And what if I don't have my gremlin on my leash, what if I have my gremlin on my leash, what, like, yes. And then somehow I freaked out, like something happened to me that I get into the swamp of, okay, I cannot be, so I felt a little bit crazy. It was like, I'm crazy now. And yes, but I have this information from my gremlin now that he loves doing experiments and he loves to do crazy experiments. And I'm so alive with that. I'm so alive with that part of me that, yeah, go out on the street and, for example, say hello to everyone. And I did like talk with other people and use Andrea and me were making this this conversation, this meta conversation list. And I picked just 5 of them and asked some people in the plane and talked with them about this. And yeah, it was so funny and crazy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There's a distinction between having your gremlin at your side and feeding your gremlin. It's two different things. And so the gremlin can do things that you cannot, your box cannot do. The gremlin can do things, it will break every rule. It can talk to anybody. And in that way, it can really serve you. But there's this balance between that and actually using experiments as gremlin food. That's not the point. The point is not how your gremlin is an important central agent to being able to do the experiments, but it's not for the gremlin. It's not for the gremlin, it's for you. So the energy needs to go through you, not through your gremlin. I think that's the difference, is that is you're in connection, not your gremlin, but your gremlin can power, you know, create, can be courageous for you. Your gremlin can be creative for you. But as soon as you put the gremlin in front and the energy starts going through the gremlin, then it's gremlin food. And then it's not going to feed your being, it's going to feed your gremlin. You get the difference?
Yes.
Great.
Thank you. And I want to add that I get this impression doing the Good Girl Busters with Eva that somehow my gremlin is really connected to my box, defending my box. And if I do this experiment, he's more connected to my being and not to my box. So I get them out, I get the, my gremlin more out of the box.
Mm-hmm. Nice, mm-hmm. Nice work. Mm-hmm. It's really great. I'm so glad that you can observe that. You can notice the difference. I'm really happy about that. And thank you for being able to speak about it. It's really powerful stuff. Thank you.
Thank you.
I am going to shift over to checking out the experiment in the book. So I have to move a couple of things here. There we go. So if everybody could take a deep breath, make sure you have your energetic center on your physical center. Use your intention, find your center, use your intention, move your center, your energetic center to your physical center. And you just, that's where its home is. You put it, your center home. Then you take a breath, use your clicker and make a grounding cord between your center and the middle of the earth. So use your clicker. And then at the count of three, you don't have to turn your microphone on, just at the count of three, tell me the color of your grounding cord out loud. One, two, three. Orange, yellow. Awesome. And click your clicker one more time and make your bubble of space. Make sure it's clean, bubble of space. Your energy inside, everybody else's energy outside. If you want, you can reach into your bag of things, pull out one of those pearls of your own energy and information, drop it in, comes down, hits your center, pops open. And as it pops open, it cleans the inside of your bubble. It pushes everything out that shouldn't be there. And only your energy and information is inside your bubble. And then if you want, you can click your clicker one more time and help. And Chloe and I hold this global space around the world that we're meeting in together. And it's a good place to start because this is what's needed to consider being a person who can experiment in the ways that we're be discussing here. So I'm on page 210 and we're in this section about called 27 Experiments for Creating Extraordinary Human Relationship. And we're on experiment number 4, which says, repeatedly experiment about not knowing your partner or the person who's standing across from you. It doesn't even have to be your partner, just whoever you're talking to, whatever, even your parents, your neighbors, even no matter how long you've known them, experiment is have no history with them in your story world. So we build up this history. I know who this person is. They always do this. They never do this. All these stories with people. So this experiment number 4 is, and like drop the stories. And the hints are, dwell on no memories. That means do not think about your memories about that person when you're with that person. So it's as if you don't have those stories or memories with them. See them now as if it is the first time you are seeing them. Perhaps even the first time you are seeing another human being. So that's a whole nother level of this experiment. Not only have you never seen this person before, you've never actually encountered a human being before. And so this whole field of wonder comes awake, this whole awe or curiosity. Or surprise, whoa. So make it be the first time you are holding their hand, the first time you're exchanging a word or an idea, the first time you're holding any hand, okay? The first time you're holding, the first time you're looking in anybody's eyes. This is your, you know, this is your chance, the first time in your life to look in anybody's eyes. There they are. What a wonderfully fulfilling experience it is to hold this incredible person's hand, to look in their eyes, to hear their voice, to sense what their life is about. So this is experiment number 4, is to and start from zero with this person across from me. And Chloe?
I have this question because, you know, for somebody who's not been doing this experiment for 20, 30, 40, or 50 years, it's like we've collected huge amounts of it is like this or
conclusions.
But it's like a man is like this, or they behave like this, or they should behave like this, or I want them to be like this, or this feels good. Like when it's like this, then it is right. Or when it's like this, then it is wrong. Or I'm wrong, or they're wrong. And it just goes, this is just this mountain of conclusions or judgments or prejudices or projections. Or so the proposal you're making is, or the book is making, let's blame it on the book.
Yes.
Is a real shift of identity to drop all that. So how do you do it?
The answer to the question how is yes.
Any hints? Any
further considerations about that is simply the doorway to an emotional healing process. So find out what you want to cling on to, what you want to hold on to for stability, for protection, for certainty, like all these things. Each one of those things is a doorway for an emotional healing process. Again, none of what anything we're ever offering here, none of it is encouraging you to allow yourself to be abused. Okay, so none of this stuff means let yourself be abused. It goes from now until page 1,000, and the book is only 500 pages long, so, or six or something. But do not let, and Chloe's question is, how do you do that? Okay, that is the path. If you go to the website called Baggage, there's 100 kinds of baggage that you can get rid of that could possibly be in the way of letting go of your resentment toward that person, or your stories about that person, or your projection. Who will you project on if you don't project on them? You need somebody to project on. And if that you cannot project on them, who are you going to project on? There's so many. I understand your question. It's really a complex thing to do. And the answer to how to do it is yes, so go ahead and do it. And so that's the experiment is, do you know how to do this? No. Can you do this? Yes.
So in your proposal, you would even have to notice that you're making such projection or conclusion, or you're holding it is like this.
Okay.
So any hints in terms of noticing?
Yes.
The water, you know, like the fish in water, like it's been the water for all this time. How do you even start noticing when you are out of the present and you start thinking you know your partner?
This experiment that who's doing it about putting the maps on the wall.
Sonia.
These maps on the wall. It's so we have these five bodies actually. And with a person across from you, all five bodies are having experiences. And so the hint is to go into experiential reality in a small now. And so, I mean, I just picked up this little thing on my desk. It's an almond. And it's like, okay, I told you a name of it, but if I didn't tell you the name of it, you go, is it an alien spaceship? You know, you can see it's like part of the planet Mercury, and the people are really small in Mercury and they drive around in spaceships like this. You know, so it's like, we don't even know what this is. It's an egg from some creature, or there's a crystal inside. Anyway, this thing, I can have an original experience of that without boxing it up in a name called, oh yeah, that's an almond. You know, it's just an almond in a shell. You know, so the point is, go search it and stay in your experiential reality and notice what you're sensing using your physical body, your intellectual body, your emotional body, and your energetic body. Like, particularly, what are you seeing, smelling, tasting, hearing? You know, what are you noticing? What, and that, and if you start with not knowing, then you have greater access to your experiential reality. And so that would be part of this experiment, is keeping a small now and staying in experiential reality. So there's a website called Minimize Now, and there's a website called Experiential Reality. And both of those are fabulous ways to do this experiment. Number four, it gives you access to immediatism.
Clinton?
Yes.
In the lab in Poland, in the intimacy lab, you told me about not mixing contexts. I asked you something about mindfulness.
And yes.
I just want to mention that what you said just now is very related to mindfulness.
Thank you for saying that. I feel really glad. It's not mindfulness, just so you know. This is not mindfulness, but because it comes from the context of possibility and possibility management. And what Catherine is saying is, if you have any questions about having more mindfulness, she is a big source. She's a well of information. She has access to practices of mindfulness. Is that true, Catherine? So call her, just have a great conversation about mindfulness. Thank you. Okay. All right, experiment number five. Do not remember any pre-existing story that your partner has told you about themselves. You know, we have this whole kind of way that we relate to people is an agreement, an unconscious, unspoken agreement that I'm going to remember and believe in the stories that you have told me about you so that I can act in a way consistent with your self stories, you know, your stories about yourself. So we make this unspoken agreement to act within the limitations or the demands of the stories that the other person has told us about themselves. And this experiment is to forget all those stories, to break the agreement. Since it's not spoken or written agreement, it's not a formal agreement, you don't have to change a contract. You can simply break the agreement because it's an unconscious agreement. You just decide not to buy into their stories about themselves. And listen instead to whatever story they are creating about themselves in that moment and repeat it back to them in that moment, remind you, so that they know you heard their story. But this is a story now. It's not about any story they ever told you before. So you repeat it back to them, so it completes it. They get that you heard it. Know that the story they are telling you now, no matter what story that is, once it is heard by you, it can completely vanish as if it never existed. You are completing the story they're having now about themselves. And you can repeat it back to them. There's no reason for them to carry that story anymore. It's gone. And as if it never existed, then an entirely new and different story can take its place. So what's amazing about this experiment is you just keep doing this over and over and over again in a course of a short period of time until you reach storylessness. Storylessness with a being next to you or across the table from you. Storylessness. You know, so many people, we're in this apartment. It's been completely empty here in Vietnam. And today, two stories down, we walk by, we see shoes in front of the door. Some people just moved in here. And what I hear inside is music. I can hear it through this closed door. this music is going. It's loud enough, it's out in the hallway. And I can hear their voices, but it's the same level of intensity. So they're running music in the background so that they cannot achieve storylessness with each other. People oftentimes have the television on in the background as a form of false community, especially in America. People do this. They just turn the TV on in the background. It's going on in the background the whole day, just so people think they're living in a community. It's so bizarre. But that kind of noise fills up this space where you could actually find storylessness with somebody else. So if you complete the story, if you forget the stories you had about them in your, you know, in yourself, you forget them, you just let them go. Just let them go by. Like a train comes and goes out of the station, Catherine will say, well, that's mindfulness. You just let the train go by and you don't get on the train. That's true. So it's like you let the stories go by, you don't get on the train, and you complete any story they make up about themselves until they kind of run out of stories. Then you're in this space of storylessness together. And the experiment is, what happens then? And don't leave that space. See how long you can stay in that space. 3 seconds. That was just 10 seconds right now. I didn't freeze up on the screen, okay? It wasn't a technical error. I was letting us have 10 seconds of storylessness and see if you started sweating or got worried about something. You know, so this can really, how long can you tolerate the intensity of being? Is it called the unbearable lightness of being? How long can you endure that? That's what this experiment is really about. So you go to this condition of storylessness and keep breathing. Not, it's just breathe normally, but see how long you can stay centered, grounded, and present in this space of storylessness. And see if you imagine being able to do that for 20 minutes. I know there's part of your brain that would come in and go, I'm wasting my time. I've got my list of all these things I have to do. And I have to just check the things off the list. And oh my God, I'm sitting here, I'm doing nothing. What would my father say? What would my teacher say? You know, all this stuff will come up. But you let it all go by and stay in storyless. This is an experiment. Anything about that experiment? Experiment number 5. Storylessness. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about.
What is dawning on me is, what if I practice this experiment of listening the other person's story to myself also, to not get on the train of my own stories and ride with it? And I wonder if it's possible for myself to just listen it, whatever comes, and give the practice of I've heard myself and let go of it.
It turns out, you can try this. Please try it. And what we've been discovering is you actually need a second consciousness, a different consciousness to complete a story. You cannot really do it by yourself. It needs you. You say it to another consciousness that hears it and then repeats back, and then it takes the second consciousness to do it. So you have whatever it is, 16 people here. You can call anybody at any time and say, "Look, please listen to my story," and then please complete my story. And they just repeat it back to you, and you go, "It's gone. It really works. It's gone," like that. But it really does take a second. But do the experiment, okay, Anna Maria?
And I would add that the purpose of this space is to relate. And so I think we're really good at discovering experiments with
then we're not involved in relating, and that's not the purpose. Yeah.
Oh, you mean like if she could do it by herself?
Yeah.
Look, if it was possible to do this stuff by ourselves, the possibility management would not exist except in a book. All right. We really need to sit in circles, sit in teams, give each other feedback and coaching, because you know, you can solve other people's problems better than your own. And so that's why we do this, is because we can't even see our own situation. We really need the team to say, that's your box, that's your gremlin, you know, that's a conclusion, that's a projection. And because we can't do it by ourselves. But if we could do it by ourselves, we wouldn't need in circles at all. But we really need each other. So it's great to come in a circle and go, I need you guys. I really need you guys to talk to me about what you see. Because everybody else has a box except me. You know, it's easy to see other people's boxes. The most difficult box to see is our own. And so that's really why we need each other. And now this other reason, it takes a second consciousness to complete stories.
I want to, somebody else?
Sorry. Yeah.
Teresa.
Yeah, I also want to add that I experienced, it's also value for me if others share their story with me. Because if I have only my own stories, there's not really value in for me. And if I listen to other stories, there's a lot of value I can get. And there's gold in the stories that we share with each other.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I also have an example about, this collaboration with each other, because when I hear my voice in the recording, I'm like, oh my God, what kind of voice do I have? But relating to other people, it's more like they don't judge me. Like they're just listening to me, looking, and okay, you are like that. And yeah, this other consciousness really helped me to accept myself where I am.
Nice, thank you.
I want to throw in, I don't know if it's one of the experiments in the 27 experiment, but it has to do with stories, but not so much stories about your partner, about themselves. But I discovered also letting my partner tell stories that he has said before, that stories about their past, mostly about their past, that I've heard before, and to just listen to them again as if I've never heard them before, and not to say, oh, I, you know, you've told me this like 10 times already, you know, I know this story.
10. 10 times. You tell me, if I told you 10 times, that's really bad.
And
okay, once or twice is okay, but 10 times.
I don't know, you know, I'm in trainings a lot with you, so the stories come back. No, and it, because there's always a new part of the story. I was like, why is this story important again at this point in their life? Or something like that. And so I used to be really irritated. Because I have this memory. I have this great memory. I remember. I said, I know the story. And I learned to relax into, I guess it's like being with the person. Yeah.
Thank you. Really, we're ready for experiment number 6. Experiment number 6 is, remember, these are experiments for creating extraordinary human relating. And this experiment number 6 is make surprises. Surprises do not involve money or gifts. And they also do not involve your gremlin in terms of a gremlin joke or gremlin surprises. So The point is, surprises, these kind of surprises do not involve physical objects or props. These kinds of surprises are delightful interactions, theater pieces created through wrapping you and your partner into unexpected qualities of space. So you get this? So your job is to wrap you and your partner together in these unexpected, surprising spatial, like a spatial circumstance. And it's so these are not practical jokes or gags, and no one is insulted. No one looks bad. These kind of surprises come from you going nonlinear into a possibility that was invisible just a moment before and did not occur to anyone else but you. And then you bring it into the space as a gift, as a surprise. Learn to shift identity, which means to speak in different accents or take on a wide variety of characters, go sideways into parallel conversations, adopt extraordinary viewpoints, and consider staying there and going back there often, not just. So most of us struggle to quote unquote be ourselves. I'm going to be myself. And here's my boundaries. And here's what I want. And here's what I need. And here's what I don't like. And here's what I don't like. And this is this whole constructed world that we try to, this is who I am as a person. Okay, right. That gets boring after about 3 seconds for the other person. So this experiment is to try something different, is to call into your interaction, your relating, a completely different dimension or domain of interacting as if this other thing is going on. And when you bring it in, when you bring this other, like here's an urgency. You know, so our little motor scooter has a name. His name is, Phyllis, you're gonna like this. His name is Gooey Duck. So a Gooey Duck, I mean, what can I say? One time Phyllis went fishing by herself or with somebody out into the Pacific Ocean when it was low tide and dug into the sand and pulled out some creatures called Gooey Ducks, which is a weird kind of long-necked clam. And she prepared them and we ate them and they were, I never even heard of them before. She goes, I made you some Gooey Ducks. This is back in college. Phyllis and I went to college together and she made these Gooey Ducks for me. And I always remember that. She really, so.
That was a surprise.
That
was a surprise. Yeah.
Yes, as a demonstration, case in point. Okay, and our motor scooter is named Gooey Duck. And so I tell Aunt Chloe about the story about the Gooey Ducks with Phyllis. And then from now on, every time we're riding our motorcycle through the water, it wants to go back in the water. And because we're in Vietnam, there's huge puddles. I mean, it was so deep, the motorcycle even stopped working. So I had to push, it was like this deep in water and I had to push the motorcycle. Anyway, so the Gooey Duck loves being in the water. Okay, so we have this thing where we're riding on a motorcycle that wants to go back in the water. This is bad news. So we're always in this kind of wrestling contest while we're driving down the road. It's a special space where the motorcycle has a different purpose than us because his name is Gooey Duck. It's a water creature. Okay, so it's stuff like that. It's just, and Chloe, you're gonna say something.
Well, just some examples. For example, the possibility of going shopping for a woman with a man. And I ended up in a few places where I see couples go shopping and neither of them know how to wrap each other into this amazing experience to try clothes on, to put on this whole new identity. And for the woman to show up as this completely new thing and the man to appreciate her and to completely be with her and appreciate her. And so, I mean, that's one way of wrapping whatever ourselves in a surprise is let the experience of shopping for new clothes be this nonlinear shift of identity. Who am I becoming? You know, whatever goddess, warrioress, queen, and the men holding space for that and being. So that's one example. And another example is we were at a cafe the other day, and I was pretty sick. I got really sick here in Vietnam for the first week. And so I was kind of sitting at the table and I was not really feeling well. And the food was taking a long time. And so Clinton decided to go get the food in the kitchen. And he went to go get the food in the kitchen and walked the whole way from the kitchen to the table like this, like with the plate in front of his hands, like to bring it to me. And all the women, all the Vietnamese women in the shop were just like, they were just amazed. You know, they're just amazed and they were laughing. But it was and instead of, you know, me saying, oh no, you shouldn't do this, or you know, I let it happen. I entered the play. I entered the theater play of being willing to receive such gifts or something like that. And but so, and it can be being involved in. I mean, some of the surprises I'm taking from my life is to. There was a waitress. We went to a really great restaurant, and there was this waitress, and we involved somebody else in our radiant space. We had a radiant space. And then there's this thing about a restaurant of this is a nice restaurant. It should be a couple thing. And it's a personal private space. And it's, you know, and the waitress is a slave anyway of the patriarchy. So we don't, you know, who cares about her? And she almost sat down at our table and had dinner with us. You know, she stayed kind of a long time and told us about her kid. But there's this element of surprise of, who can also this person become in our space of radiance? I mean, I just examples, and that's also involving another person. But we were in Spain a long time ago, and we were sitting at a cafe, and we'd had just this amazing radiance space, and this waitress comes and she comes singing out. She comes singing out onto the courtyard and pouring us our sparkling water. And she's singing and she walks back and she has this beautiful dress. And then we go and after a while we go and pay and we ask, well, do you often sing like that to your customers? She said, I never do this. Like, I'm sorry, you know, I never. And we were just like, no, this was fantastic. But
she's like singing opera.
Yeah.
It was amazing.
But also, I just want to say, for example, as a woman, for a man to hear a woman singing in a house is a delightful thing. You know, when you hear the woman singing when they cook, that means the women are happy. Womanhood is happening. And so to that, this is also a surprise, and it doesn't have to be I'm singing for you, but I'm singing for the space. That
so that little thing has taken 3 or 4 years to evolve, where every tiny hum that comes out of Anne Chloe, I say, I love it when you sing. Mm-hmm. It's fantastic when you I just bask in your singing. And it was working so amazing that she even took a singing lesson, online singing lesson from this guy. And all of a sudden her singing went to this whole new level because she was being appreciated. And it was just this fantastic thing now where she's singing a lot and it's wonderful. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, she's a singer. And she never knew it. You know, she never knew that she was really a singer. It's just been. So that kind of surprise is fantastic. And I just wanted to say another one. Just today, this afternoon, it was raining and we're on the motorcycle and we have to get some vegetables. And so there's a market not so far from where we live on the way home. And it was late, it was 12 o'clock and most of the market things are closed, but we found two little stands that were open. And so usually I'm carrying this stuff, whatever, and Chloe's picking out some, and she knew a particular vendor lady. And so I just split off and I went to the next vendor lady. And so we start this conversation between these two vendor ladies who are competitors, you know, and they're competing against each other for who's gonna buy the onions. And so I'm going, how did you get onions? How many onions did you get? And then so, no, I didn't get the onions. And then what about the tomatoes? And I found this breadfruit and a pineapple. And so it was like the woman could not speak English. So her son comes over. And so he's translating stuff for me and his mom. And he's this tall and his mom is this tall. And there was this friendly abundance of, we were just buying everything. Like, and Chloe was over there just buying, I want some of this and some of that. And we just kept buying new things. They thought, and so both of them kind of made a bunch of money in the off hours because we were playing around. And not only that, but the son, he spoke English well enough, I could give him one of these cards for the start over game. So we have a new Vietnamese player now in the start over game. So, and that's, so there was this huge win happening just from buying vegetables. So, and that's what this experiment is about, yeah?
I mean, and one part of the experiment is you can make your partner's neurosis a surprise for you. And I want to give an example for that is I have this neurosis somehow, this ability to never put an object in the same place that I found it. So it drives Clinton crazy because he's but it used to drive Clinton crazy because the hairbrush is never where I, you know, where he left it because I've moved it, or the toothpaste, or even the knife is, and I mean, another story is I left the knife on the door of the refrigerator. And so Clinton opened the door of the refrigerator and the knife fell. Not on
towards my bare feet. The big knife, not the little knife, the big sharp butcher knife. So falls off. Anyway.
So stuff like that. But it took a few years for Clinton, but then now it became this thing where it's like, okay, then it's a surprise. He can never know where to find the thing. And so he has to enter my world of being, where could she has put it? Where, what, retrace the steps or try to get into my field of, but it became a part of our intimacy instead of being this neurotic, you know, I hate it when you do this. Yeah. I hate it when you do this. And so.
Yeah, I get to practice scanning. She gives me all these opportunities for scanning for the dental floss, you know, scan for the mustard, scan. And it's true. It's not a fake thing. It's not really, it's not a fake thing. It's as true as you make it. And I make it totally true for me. So it's a challenge. It means there's so many opportunities in our day-to-day life for engaging them in a new way, or engaging them in a way of how can I make, what is the surprise that's wrapped up in this circumstance right now? And how can I maximize the surprise of it? And did anybody have any comments about that or anything?
Sorry. Go ahead.
I have a resonance, but it is not completely related to what you have said just now. But it reminds me on a situation I had this week with a student who was complaining the process of judging his final paper. So I'm in charge of, I needed to tell him it's not good enough and we need to find a solution. And it is important probably to know that he is a man 10 years older than me at least, and it's some kind of a bad situation. And I said something like, well, for me, this situation is very interesting. It's some kind, I experienced that for the first time. And his reaction was, well, for me, it is very annoying to sit here with you and to discuss this thing. And I guess it is some kind of like culture to culture conversation or, and it, yeah, it was, yeah, it is probably, it is weird somehow.
Could you take the conversation to further levels? You know, you say, you tell me why it's disgusting. What do you say? And you tell us why it's interesting. I'll tell you why it's interesting and I tell you why it's disgusting. And those, what about that? Can you, that was a door. He opens a door. This is annoying for me.
Yes.
You go, excellent, excellent. Talk about what the annoyance is. And you make this space, and then he tells you, and you go, yeah, and that's why this is interesting. It's special for me to have a man tell me these kind of details about his inner world. This is fascinating. So you can take it down these levels.
Mm. We didn't do that. It was more that I was saying, yes, I can understand that it is annoying for you.
Ah, you completed
and that it.
Is.
Yes, and that it is probably not professional from me to tell you, for me it is interesting. So I lost a little bit my culture.
Ah, okay. Okay. Yeah, very cool. Thank you for sharing that.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Anybody else, something else? Okay. So these are experiments. These are not rules. These are channels, or these are opening doors. So I'd like to read one more before we exit the space. This is experiment number 7. The experiment is be early. Do not make your partner wait for you. Think ahead and be proactive instead. Learn to move faster than the speed of time, which is very simple to do. All you have to do, that means do whatever it takes without rushing to arrive where you are intended to be before the clock gets there. Before the minute hand of the clock gets to the time you're supposed to meet, you get there. So you're moving faster than time. You get that? You arrive at where you're supposed to be before the clock does, and then you're moving faster than the speed of time. This is a superpower, because most of us chase the clock. You know, the clock goes tick, tick. We go, oh my God, I have to go, yeah, I have to go, oh, can I do all this with tick? Can I do all this stuff? I'm going to get it all done before tick, tick, oh shit, oh no, no, like this. We're chasing the clock. Okay, this is a victim situation with time. So many people in modern culture are victims with regards to time. And then they take their victimhood and their stress and they put it on their partner. Like, ah, I couldn't make it. I have to come up with reasons and excuses. And the whole conversation that you're having is about the reasons and excuses. And then, yeah, but I was waiting around. I thought you forgot about this, blah, blah, you know. It's a horrible kind of ordinary conversation. It's really ordinary. It's boring. So what you can do is arrive where you're intended to be before the clock gets there. So that means get present. You have a chance to have center, grounding, core, bubble, and presence before your partner even arrives. And then what you do in these moments is truly enjoy yourself while waiting for your partner to join you. So you're ahead of time. You know, like in the ordinary world, an agreement like this would have to be fair. You know, fair is you both come at the right place at exactly the same time. and then nobody has to wait for anybody else. Okay, that's fair. Okay, but that's completely neurotically insane in terms of, it's like trying to be perfect. It's just a neurotic, insane goal. So instead, intend for it to be unfair. You play an unfair game and you arrive first and you wait and you are so present and centered. I can't tell you how many times I have seen exactly what I needed to see or hear because I arrived earlier than expected. You know, I get there before people expect me to be there. They're not ready. Okay, the situation is not ready. I see so much of what's going on in their not ready state that by the time we talk, I already know what's going on. I already know what's, you know, what the problem is. I know what the solution is. I know the whole game, what their gremlin's up to, because I arrived 3 or 5 minutes early. It's just given to me. So it's such a powerful thing to move faster than the speed of time. But part of it is enjoying your own company, enjoying yourself while waiting for your partner to join you. And so a lot of us have this thing of, well, I don't really love myself, or, you know, I can't stand to be with myself, or I'm not perfect, so I have to beat myself up. Every time I'm with myself, I criticize myself, or I judge myself, or I blame myself, or have these stories going on. It's fucking, and so that's what this voice blaster is for. You know, bang, shoot the voices. You know, you can, you do not have to do the gremlin self cannibalism on yourself. Really, that you can go through that. That does not have to be your life. So you can go to a place where you actually enjoy hanging out with yourself. So how many of you like already enjoy hanging out with yourself? How many of you do whatever you can to not hang out with yourself because you don't like it really? How many people did not answer the question? Okay. Human beings, we are such a funny thing. We're really this snarl of conflicting forces. The more I do this work, the more I think that the knots that we tie ourselves in are unnecessary. They're just left over. They're kind of an unnecessary thing. And it's each one of them, I think, has the purpose of survival, of trying to protect ourselves or take care of ourselves. And there's an extra experiment in number 7, I guess. The extra experiment is realize that your survival strategy worked. Your survival strategy worked. It was meant for you to make it until you're 18 years old, because that's when you need to survive, is until you're 18. And then you can step into the world with your own responsibility. But before then, you don't really have enough responsibility or consciousness to step in the world and deal with the world as it is. But when you're 18, you can. And so what you can do is realize that everything you did to survive, it worked. And you can just take a deep breath and go, oh, survival is over. I did it already. I already survived. Really, you can pat yourself on the back. You should do this once a day for about a year. Just pat yourself on the back and go, I survived. I made it. I survived. I did a good job. I made it. Just pat yourself on the back and you just go, good job. And then every time you do that, let one more of those knots go. I have to do it like this. I can't do that. This is not okay. I have to watch out for this. There's all these survival things. Just go, hey, I already survived. It's leftovers. I don't know. It's like you go into a movie theater when they turn the lights on, you know, after the movie is over, you're going, ah, you know, and da da da, and the movie's over. Then they turn the lights on. You go, ah, I survived. And what's left is these popcorn boxes you know, and empty Coke cans and candy wrappers, you know, and that's what's left over. Okay, it's the mess that's left over from survival. What do you do with it? Well, you just sweep it up and put it in the garbage can and that's it. But you do have a mess. There is a mess left over after you survive. It's a side effect, it's an after effect. And so the things that you discover, you don't have to carry them on anymore into your adult life because you already survived. Adulthood is not about surviving. Extraordinary relating is not about survival. You're still in this survival mode. You cannot enter extraordinary, but you're still stuck in the survival mode. You're not actually present as yourself. You're surviving. You're doing whatever it takes to survive. So it's great to let the, keep congratulating yourself and letting those artifacts left over from your survival strategy just fall off into the river of time and just go back because you already survived.
I was just proposing for the last few minutes, if anybody want to ask for emotional healing process in regards to what we've been talking about today and the blocks to any of the experiments. Because if you don't remove the blocks, or like Clinton said, remove the knots, you won't be able to do the experiments. You'll be just thinking about them.
The way this works is you just say, yes, I'd like, could somebody be with me for an emotional healing process about whatever? And you just make the agreement right here. And then you can work out the time later. Mm-hmm.
I want to do the emotional healing process for this story I have, that I have to do it alone, and that I'm not open for relating. So who would like to help me to do this?
Dorothea and Phyllis, just write their names down and then connect with them and set up a time. Super. This is how it goes, just like that. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Maria. Anyone else? Anything else?
I have a similar story that I have that I want to do it alone. So I'd like to explore that with someone. Who would be willing to explore that with me?
I see Calista and Anna Maria. Mm. Great team.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? It's Christmas time, you know. You get what you ask for.
Yes. I also have the story that I have to be alone because I don't know how to relate. And I'm asking, is someone willing to hold space for me for an EHP, please?
I see Katrin and Kinu. Yeah.
Thank you.
Katrin and Kinu. Anyone else? You know, we have the whole emotional healing process team that's available to us, but doing it with these people in this space is really special just because we've been on this journey and we know exactly what the framework was when we're asking for the process. So it's just great to do it, processes with people in the study group.
I want to mention that Nicole is holding this great EHP dojo on Tuesday evening.
Where can people get information about that?
She posted in the village, in the Telegram groups.
Great. If anybody's not on the Telegram group for the Creation Village or the other ones, just let us know and we'll get you the links. Mm-hmm.
There's also an EHP dojo on Monday morning from Annika.
Yay. I'm so glad. Mm-hmm. I'm so glad about these dojos. Okay, would everybody please take a deep breath, and we're going to banish this space and clean it out, but take whatever you want that you got from this and for experiments or Anything else? Have a great week and just really experiment at the edge of the world, in the frontier. Experiment at the frontier. Great. Nice to be with you. Thank you all very much for being
Thank
here.
You.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.